Welcome to the What If Analysis Participation Project for the WV Mining Problem. In this assignment, we're going to take a look at tools in Excel to go and understand relationships between data and to go and manage different sets of variables for various calculations. To get started, I've downloaded and extracted the provided data files, and I've opened up the starter file here in Excel. The first thing that we're going to do is explore correlation. Correlation is a statistical tool that allows us to go and determine if there is a relationship between two sets of variables, in that if one variable changes in a certain direction, say it goes up, the other variable consistently exhibits a similar pattern. It either will go up, or if there's a negative correlation, it'll go down. Correlation allows us to go and measure that potential relationship between two variables. And it's going to be something that will be on a range between negative 1 and positive 1, where values that are closer to the extremes mean that there is a stronger correlation between the two sets of data. Correlation near 0 means that there's really not much relationship there at all. Correlation is good to understand if there's a potential that one variable might impact the other, but it doesn't always guarantee that. Remember, correlation is not causation. Let's take a look here at the coal mine sheet for this calculation. And we have down at the bottom here this correlation column. What we want to do here is go and see if the amount of coal that was mined in that column above has any correlation to the prices for the corresponding year over on our prices sheet. In the instructions, you're given a formula that you can go and use for this, but we'll go ahead and just write this ourselves for this video. In cell C64, I'm going to start off my formula with an equal sign, and then I'm going to use the CORREL function, CORREL. And I need to give CORREL two input parameters with the two different sets of data that I'm trying to compare. So for this first set of data here, I'm going to go and select the coal mined for 1999 for all the counties. So I'm going to select each of the counties individually here, because in order for our correlation to really work, we need to have a bunch of data points. If I just go through and show the total amount and the total average price, that's not going to go through and give me, if I'm just looking at a state basis, I need to have data for each of the counties. So I've selected all of the counties here on the coal mine sheet for 1999, and then I'm going to type in a comma, and then for the second parameter, I'm going to head over to the prices sheet and select all the counties for 1999 as well. Go ahead and close up my parentheses and hit enter. So you can see we have this correlation for 1999 that's 0.04, which means there's not really much of a correlation there at all. Let's go ahead and copy this over. I'll actually use the autofill handle for this, but we're going to go over to column G so we can see these other years. And I'm just going to tell it with the little option here that I want to fill with that formatting, because I'm interested in the formula, but I'm not interested in the actual borderline that got brought over initially. So we can see these values are all kind of dancing around zero. In fact, we actually have zero correlation for 2004, and these other years we have pretty slight correlation, a very slight negative correlation here. This one here in 2019 is the strongest at a 0.08, and even that is pretty negligible. You really need to get to sort of about 0.2 before you really even start to see that there might even be a correlation there. So you can see here in this particular case between coal mine production and prices, there really isn't any sort of relationship. But other data sets, you might see something. Correlation is really a useful tool for trying to explore what relationships might exist. Now we're ready to take a look at creating scenarios. We're going to head over to the forecast sheet for this. And what scenarios do is they give us a convenient way to store contents for specific cells that we're interested in. In our case, what we're going to do here is store different scenarios to identify potential ways that coal production could fare in the future. We're going to create three possible scenarios here. For our first scenario, we're going to take a look at a forecast from Marshall University in 2019, and it expects that the amount of coal that's produced in 2024 is going to be 18% less than was produced in 2019. So that's actually what this initial set of data is based off of here. So it's projecting that from about 100 million tons of coal a year produced in West Virginia, it's going to drop to about 82 million. We're going to go and set up the values here for this scenario. In cell A3, where it just says scenario right now, I'm going to actually type in the name of the scenario that I want. That way, when I'm looking at this sheet, it's easy at a glance for me to tell what scenario I've actually loaded. So for A3, I'm going to type in 2019 Marshall University forecast. The other cell that I'm going to store as part of the scenario is B4, and this one should be minus 18%. So that's actually what's there already. I'm going to store cells A3, where I have my description of what scenario we're looking at, and B4, which is the only actual value that I'm changing, as part of the scenario. So what I've done is I've actually selected both those cells. I just held down the control key on my keyboard, sort of allowed me to select both of them. And I'm going to go to the data ribbon. Under the forecast section here, you'll see this what if analysis. And we want to go to scenario manager. Right now, there aren't any scenarios. We're going to create one. We'll click the add button, and we're going to call this scenario Marshall forecast. The changing cells, it contains information on which cells are going to be stored as part of this scenario. Here, it already figured out A3 and B4 because I had those cells selected when I went into Scenario Manager. So those are fine as is. The comment is something that is auto-generated by Excel, and it just contains which user created the scenario and on what day. I'm gonna go ahead and click the OK button. And then you'll see here for each of the changing cells that were specified, these are the values that are gonna be stored for those cells in the scenario. So it just grabs whatever contents they happen to have at the moment. So A3 has this 2019 Marshall University forecast. B4 is a decimal representation of minus 18%. So that's the minus 0.18. These are good as is. So we'll go ahead and click OK. And you can see now we'll have this scenario listed. And when I go into Scenario Manager, if I go and change something and I want to be able to view a particular scenario, I can just click on the name of the scenario and tell it to show. For right now, though, I'm going to go ahead and click Close and get out of Scenario Manager. I want to create a second scenario now that is going to assume just a 10% drop in production rather than the 18% decrease that Marshall is forecasting. Let's go to cell A3, and I'm going to change my description here. I'm going to say that I want to call this 10% drop so that I know when I'm viewing this data which scenario I'm going to be looking at. And in cell B4, I need to go and enter the new value. So I'm going to type in a minus 10%. You can see when I went and changed that value, it went and recalculated this because these are all based off of formulas here that reference that cell. So now we're saying we're going to have about 90 million tons, whereas earlier with the Marshall scenario, it was 82 million tons in 2024. I'm going to go back and select cells A3 and B4 again, and we'll set up a scenario for this particular case. So on the data ribbon, under What If Analysis, I'm going to go back into Scenario Manager. I'll click Add, and I want to call this scenario 10% drop. The changing cells is fine, so I'll click OK. And these are the values it just picked up from what I had entered, so that's okay. So now I have two scenarios listed here. And like I said, I can click on the one that I'm interested in, tell it to show, and it'll go and flip the values that we have stored as part of that scenario. So everything else here that you can see when I'm going and changing these percentages goes and recalculates off that. So the coal production, estimates, and then based on the pricing here, the value of that coal changes as we go and go from one scenario to the other. Let's set up one more scenario, and for this scenario, we're going to try to figure out how much coal production we need to increase to get us back to 1999 levels. In cell A3, I'm going to enter a description for this scenario, and I'm going to type in return to 1999 levels. In B4, I'm going to go and set this just to 0. Strictly speaking, I don't have to do that, but it's going to make this next step go a little bit smoother. So what we want to do is we're going to try to find the value for cell B4 that's going to make it so that G16, which is the total production for 2024, is equal to 169,206,834 tons. So what we're going to use is a tool called GoalSeek, and it's going to basically play around with different potential values for B4 until it finds one that actually gets us to our target goal here in G16. So with the cell that we want to try to find this target value for, the one that we have the goal for, selected, so G16, on the data ribbon, I'm going to go to What If Analysis and click on GoalSeek. And here I'm going to tell it that I want to set cell G16 to a value, and I'm going to enter the number here, 169,206,834, and I'm going to do that by changing cell, and I'll just click on the cell selector here and tell it that I want to change B4. I'm going to click it OK. You can see it's kind of checks out different options, and in the end here it found a solution. So it says this is your target, this is the current value of what it was able to find. Sometimes it may search for a little while, and every once in a while you'll run into cases where it can't find anything, or at least as Excel was trying, it can't find anything. Sometimes going through and setting the value that you're trying to change to something different and restarting the search can help nudge it. It's not a perfect solution, but it does go and work in most cases here. It works pretty well in probably 95% of cases. There is a more advanced version of this called Solver that we'll take a look at separately that allows you to place constraints on when you're going through and solving values. GoalSeek is pretty straightforward. It's just, you know, change this to whatever it needs to be to get this target. But that's what we're looking for with this project here. I'm going to go ahead and click OK, and you can see that in order to hit our target, production is going to have to increase 68.69%. What we want to do is set up this last scenario in Scenario Manager so that we can store this value. I'm going to click on cell A3, and then I'll also click on B4. I'm going to go to What If Analysis, and we'll click on Scenario Manager, and I'm going to add this scenario, and I'll call it Return to 1999 Levels, and hit OK. And you can see we had the number formatted to two decimal places here. This is the actual underlying number that's really there. So there's really a whole ton of decimal digits going on. But that's what we need. So we'll click OK. And now I can just sort of go between these different ones and see the outcomes of those different results. One nice thing is that when you do create scenarios, Excel has a tool that will generate what's called a scenario summary that allow you to go and compare the outcomes of those different scenarios. I'm going to go and head back into Scenario Manager. So I'll go to What If Analysis on the data ribbon and go to Scenario Manager. And I'm going to click this summary button. And I'm going to tell it that I want a scenario summary. And my result cells, I'm going to select G16 because this is what I'm really interested in comparing, how much coal gets produced as a result of these different scenarios. I'm going to click OK. And you'll see we get this new tab that's going to pop up here. And it'll have each of our scenarios listed. It's going to show the different cell values that are stored as part of that scenario. So we have the label from A3 and then the actual value from B4. And then it's going to show for that result cell, or if we had multiple cells, all of the cells, what the different values are for them when we have this set of input variables. So it makes it really easy for us to kind of go and compare that this input is going to result in this output. Let's go head over to the analysis question sheet and wrap up the project. There's a single question here, and it's going to be 6A. This question prompt is going to be one of those subjective type questions. There's not necessarily a correct right answer. You just need to go and explain your reasoning for why you choose as you do. The prompt here is, which of the three projected scenarios for coal mining in 2024 do you believe is most accurate and why? I'm going to write that I believe the Marshall scenario is most accurate. It is based off research data compiled by a major university in the state and reflects recent trends. So that's my answer. Pretty much I've said what my choice is and why. So you don't need to have anything fancy. You know, two or three sentences are sufficient for basically every type of analysis question that you're going to see this semester. At this point, you'll want to save your work, close out of Excel, and submit the participation project.